Good morning, student. Today we have lecture on the deep cervical fascia. Competencies for the today's lecture are: describe the parts, extent, attachments, modifications of deep cervical fascia. Objectives are: what is deep cervical fascia? What is its extent, attachments, and modifications of the deep cervical fascia? So in this lecture we are going to see the extent, attachment, and various modifications of the deep cervical fascia. Deep cervical fascia is also known as the fascia collar. Deep fascia around the neck is known as the deep cervical fascia. It is nothing but the laminar condensation of loose alveolar tissue in the neck. So the deep cervical fascia is nothing but the laminar condensation of the loose alveolar tissue in the neck. These laminae encase the various structures in the neck, such as muscles, glands, vessels, etc. Why it is important to study the deep cervical fascia? It is important to study this deep cervical fascia because it forms various facial spaces in the neck which are surgically important. It provides capsule to the glands and innervates the muscles. It forms a protective sheath around the neurovascular structures. Also, it forms the facial planes to direct the spread of infection or pus in the neck. That's why it is important to study the deep cervical fascia of the neck. So it is very important topic to study because it forms the various facial spaces. You have a lecture on the facial spaces in between our curriculum, and that time you will realize how these facial spaces are formed. Then it also forms the capsule around the glands and innervates the muscles. Also, it forms the protective sheath around the neurovascular structures. And it forms the facial planes to direct the spread of infection or the pus in the neck. Layers of the deep cervical fascia. A single fascia takes different names in different rejoints and continues with each other directly or indirectly through the loose alveolar tissue. Deep fascia gives different laminae by condensation and thickening. Modifications of the deep cervical fascia are: investing layer, pretracheal layer, prevertebral layer, carotid sheath, buccopharyngeal fascia, temporal fascia, pharyngobasilar fascia, and the alar fascia. So these are the modifications of the deep cervical fascia of the neck. But the most important are the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia, pretracheal layer, prevertebral layer, and the carotid sheath. Okay. So, and you can nicely appreciate all these these four layers during your dissection. So here you can see the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. Here is the prevertebral layer, and here is the pretracheal layer of the deep cervical fascia. Deep cervical fascia supports the viscera, especially the thyroid gland, muscles, vessels, deep lymphatic nodes. It condenses around the carotid arteries, internal jugular veins, and the vagus nerve to form the carotid sheath. It forms the natural cleavage planes, which helps tissues may be separated during the surgery. It limits the spread of infection. So these natural cleavage planes helps in separating the various layers during the surgery. And also it limits the spread of infection. It affords slipperiness, which allows the structure in the neck to move and pass over one another without difficulty. So these are the main functions of the deep cervical fascia. It supports the viscera, muscles, vessels, etc. It condenses around the various neurovascular trunk to form the carotid sheath. Then it forms the natural cleavage planes and it affords the slipperiness. Deep cervical fascia of the neck has four main different components. Investing layer, which surrounds the neck like collar. Prevertebral fascia, which lies in front of the vertebral rejoint. Pretracheal layer, which lies in front of the trachea and surrounds the thyroid gland. Carotid sheath, it is the special condensation of the tissue around the common carotid artery, internal jugular vein and the vagus nerve, and it will form the carotid sheath. So, investing layer, prevertebral fascia, pretracheal layer and the carotid sheath, these are the four main different components of the deep cervical fascia. Here you can nicely appreciate these four layers. Here is the investing layer, here is the prevertebral layer, and here is the pretracheal layer, and here is the carotid sheath. Okay. Investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. It is the outer layer of the deep cervical fascia, which forms the surface cover for the structures of the neck. It invests the neck like a collar. It lies just deep to the platysma muscle and the superficial fascia. It is disposed in cylindrical manner. Attachment of the investing layer. Superiorly, it is attached to the external occipital protuberance, superior nuchal line, mastoid process, zygomatic arches, inferior border of the mandible, hyoid bone, spinous process of the cervical vertebrae. So these are the superiorly, it is attached like this from the external occipital protuberance, superior nuchal line. Then you come to the lateral side, that is the mastoid process, zygomatic arches, inferior border of the mandible, then hyoid bone, spinous process of the cervical vertebra. Inferiorly, it is attached to the manubrium, clavicles, acromions, and spines of the scapula. Posteriorly, it is continuous with the periosteum of the spinous process of the seven cervical vertebra and the nuchal line. So, inferiorly, it is attached to the manubrium, clavicles, and the acromion and the spines of the scapula. Posteriorly, it is continuous with the periosteum of the spinous process of the seven cervical vertebra and the nuchal ligament. So, these are the attachments of the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. Investing layer should be studied at three different levels, at the base of the skull, in the neck, and at the root of the neck. So, first we'll see at the base of the skull. Investing layer is attached to form this investing layer is attached to from behind forward to the external occipital protuberance, superior nuchal line, mastoid process with external acoustic meatus and the symphysis menti. Covering of the parotid gland and the masseter muscle is known as the parotidomassetric fascia. So, at the base of the skull, it is attached to the external occipital protuberance, superior nuchal line, mastoid process, external acoustic meatus, and the symphysis menti. The investing layer of the deep fascia, which covers the parotid gland and the masseter muscle, is known as parotidomassetric fascia. It is attached to the zygomatic arch. It is tough and tight and supplied by the great auricular nerve, which also supplies the temporal rejoint. Fluctuation cannot be elicited in case of parotid abscess due to the tough fascia over the parotid gland. Due to the innervation of the great auricular nerve, swelling or the abscess of the parotid rejoint presents with pain in the temporal rejoint, that is the referred pain. So, showing the attachment at the base of the skull, it will start from the posteriorly external occipital protuberance, then superior nuchal line, then mastoid process, then it will split to invade the parotid gland, then it will attach to the angle of the mandible. Again, it will split into two layers to cover the submandibular salivary gland. Then again, it will fuse and again it will split to enclose the anterior belly of the digastric, and then it will attach to the symphysis menti. So in this way, here is the attachment of the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. At the base of the skull, investing layer splits thrice to enclose the parotid gland, submandibular gland, and the anterior belly of the digastric muscle. So these three structures are invested by the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. Deep layer of the parotid gland forms the specialized condensation between the tip of the styloid process and the angle of the mandible, that is known as the stylomandibular ligament. Another condensation between the spine of the sphenoid to lingula of the mandible is known as the spinomandibular ligament. So, thickening of the investing layer will form the two important ligaments. One is stylomandibular ligament and one is spinomandibular ligament. So, here is the zygomatic arch. Here is the superficial layer of the parotid fascia. And here is the parotid gland. So, this is the superficial layer and this will be the deep layer. And it will enclose the parotid gland. Okay, so here is the styloid process, and between the styloid process and the angle of the mandible, there is a stylomandibular ligament. Here is a stylomandibular ligament. Here you can see the spinomandibular ligament, and here you can see the stylomandibular ligament. Okay, so two ligaments, spinomandibular ligament and the stylomandibular ligament. So, investing layer of the deep cervical fascia enclosing the two glands, one is parotid and the one is submandibular gland. So, here is the submandibular gland which is invested by the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. This is the deep layer and this is the superficial layer. Okay, here is again you can nicely appreciate the two layers of the investing layer, which invests the parotid gland, and this superficial layer is forms the parotidomesenteric fascia. In the neck, it starts from the spine of the seventh cervical vertebra and ligamentum nuchae posteriorly. So, in the neck, it will start from the spine of the seventh cervical vertebra and the ligamentum nuchae posteriorly. As it encircles the neck, it splits into two layers to enclose the trapezius and the sternocleidomastoid muscle. So, it will enclose the two muscles, trapezius and the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Tracing horizontally, when traced forward from behind ligamentum nuchae, it splits at the posterior margin of the trapezius and encloses it. It reunites at its anterior margin to form the single layer, and it will form the roof of the posterior triangle of the neck. Okay, as it reaches the posterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, it again splits to enclose the sternocleidomastoid muscle. At the anterior border, it again reunites to form the single layer which forms the roof of the anterior triangle. So, it will enclose the two muscles, trapezius and the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and it will form the roof of the two triangles, roof of the posterior triangle and the anterior triangle. So, here you can see ligamentum nuchae and the spine of the seventh cervical vertebra. From here, it will at the posterior border of the trapezius muscle, it will split to enclose that muscle. Again, it will reunite to form the layer and it will form the roof of the posterior triangle. Then at the posterior border of the sternocleidomastoid, again it will split to enclose the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and again it will reunite at the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and it will form the roof of the anterior triangle. Okay. So these two arrows show the roof of the anterior and the posterior triangles. So in this way, these are the two triangles, anterior triangles and the posterior triangle, and the roof is formed by the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. At the roof of the posterior triangle, running from the superior nuchal line, it encloses the spinal root of the accessory nerve and lower down inferior belly of the omohyoid muscle. Its two layers get attached to anterior and the posterior borders of the clavicle. Thus, the space is formed, and that is known as the omohyoid interspace or the supraclavicular space. So the supraclavicular space is formed by the two layers, which are of the investing layer, which are attached to the anterior and the posterior borders of the clavicle. And this supraclavicular space contains the inferior belly of the omohyoid, external jugular vein, subclavian vein, and its tributaries, along with the supraclavicular nerves. So in this diagram, you can nicely appreciate the supraclavicular space. Here is the supraclavicular space. Okay. Again, here you can see the supraclavicular space along with its content. Vertical tracing in the middle of the neck. Vertically, it is attached to the symphysis menti and the hyoid bone. Here is the symphysis menti and here is the hyoid bone. So it is attached to the symphysis menti and the hyoid bone. It splits into two layers above the manubrium sterni to enclose the suprasternal space. So above the manubrium sterni, it will split into again two layers to form the suprasternal space of bones. It contains the interclavicular ligament, sternal head of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, jugular venous arch, which connects the two anterior jugular veins, and the loose areolar tissue. So vertical tracing in the midline of the neck of the investing layer is, it is attached to the symphysis menti to the hyoid bone, then it splits into two layers at the upper margin of the manubrium sterni to enclose the suprasternal space, and this suprasternal space contains the interclavicular ligament, sternal head of the sternocleidomastoid muscle, jugular venous arch, which connects the two anterior jugular veins and the loose areolar tissue. So here again you can nicely appreciate the suprasternal space of bone. At the root of the neck, it is attached in continuous line from the spine of the scapula, acromion process, clavicle, and the sternum. So here you can see the attachment. Okay. Showing anterior midline tracing of the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia, symphysis menti. Then here is the hyoid bone and the manubrium sterni. So it is, this is the midline attachment of the investing layer. To sum up, rule of two. Deep investing layer of the deep cervical fascia splits to enclose two muscles, and these two muscles are the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius muscle. It gives two facial processes, pretracheal and the prevertebral layers. It forms the roof of the two triangles, anterior and the posterior triangles of the neck. It splits to form the two spaces, suprasternal space and the supraclavicular space. It splits to enclose two salivary glands, parotid gland and the submandibular gland. It is thickened twice to form the parotidomacetric fascia and the stylomandibular ligament. It forms the two slings for the intermediate tendon of the digastric and the omohyoid. So this is the rule of two for the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. So these are the two facial slinges formed by the investing layer. Here is the anterior belly of the digastric and here is the posterior belly of the digastric. Superior belly of the omohyoid and the inferior belly of the omohyoid, which are attached to the attached by the sling. Coming to the pretracheal fascia, it lies anterior to the trachea, as the name suggests. It is confined to the anterior aspect of the neck. It is one of the laminae of the deep fascia. It arises from the layer of the investing deep cervical fascia, which lies deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Disposition or the tracing of the pretracheal layer. Horizontally, after arising from the deep fascia deep to the sternocleidomastoid, it forms the anterior wall of the carotid sheath. Then it splits to enclose the thyroid gland and lies in front of the trachea and finally becomes continuous with the opposite side. From the back of the thyroid gland, a special thickening runs to the up to the cricoid cartilage, that is known as the suspensory ligament of the belly. So from the back of the thyroid gland, a special thickening runs to cricoid cartilage to form the suspensory ligament of the belly. So here is the suspensory ligament of the belly. Here is the thyroid cartilage. Here is the cricoid cartilage. Okay. Vertically from above downwards, hyoid bone is in the midline, oblique line of the thyroid cartilage. So it will be attached to the hyoid bone in the midline, oblique line of the thyroid cartilage, then cricoid cartilage. It splits to enclose the thyroid gland, okay, and form the outer false capsule of the thyroid gland. Then it runs downwards in front of the trachea and enters in the mediastinum. It ends by fusing with the apex of the fibrous pericardium. So it will extend up to the fibrous pericardium. So vertically, pretracheal fascia is attached to the hyoid bone, oblique line of the thyroid cartilage, cricoid cartilage split to enclose the thyroid gland, and it forms the false capsule of the thyroid gland. Then it runs downwards in front of the trachea and entered in the mediastinum. Important features of the pretracheal fascia are: it forms the outer false capsule for the thyroid gland. It forms the suspensory ligament or the ligament of Bayley. It is nothing but the thickened band from the posterior aspect of the thyroid gland and attached to the cricoid cartilage. It supports the thyroid gland and prevents its downward displacement. During the operation for removal of the thyroid gland, this ligament must be cut for mobilization of the gland. So you must know the position of the ligament of Bayley for the surgery of the thyroid gland. During the enlargement of the thyroid gland, there may be embrasment of the heart due to the fusion of the pretracheal fascia with the fibrous pericardium. There will be traction, and because of that, patient may complain about the chest pain. Continuity of the facial space. There is a continuity of the facial spaces of the neck with mediastinum. So any infection may spread from the neck to the mediastinum or vice versa. Thyroid gland moves during the swallowing due to the attachment of the pretracheal layer to the hyoid bone, thyroid and the cricoid cartilages and forms the outer false capsule of the gland. Pretracheal fascia is limited in the anterior part of the neck. It extends from inferiorly from hyoid to the thorax. It encloses the infrahyoid muscles, thyroid gland, trachea, esophagus, and the pharynx. It is continuous posteriorly and superiorly with the buccopharyngeal fascia. Pretracheal fascia, which covers the posterior surface of the thyroid gland, is ill-defined or thin. Enlargement in the posterior direction of the thyroid gland may compress the esophagus because the fascia is ill-defined or it is very thin. Coming to the prevertebral fascia, it forms the tubular sheath for the vertebral column and the muscles of it. It is attached superiorly to the cranial base, anteriorly separated from the pharynx and the buccopharyngeal fascia by the retropharyngeal space. So here is the retropharyngeal space, here is the prevertebral fascia, and here is the buccopharyngeal fascia. Okay. Inferiorly merge with the endothoracic fascia, laterally extend as an axillary sheath. So the prevertebral fascia attached superiorly to the cranial base, anteriorly separated from the pharynx and the buccopharyngeal fascia by the retropharyngeal space. Inferiorly merges with the endothoracic fascia, laterally extend as an axillary sheath. Prevertebral fascia is a tough membrane situated in front of the prevertebral muscles. It arises from that part of the cervical fascia which lies deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. It lies in front of the cervical vertebrae and behind the pharynx and the esophagus. It spreads laterally on both the sides across the floor of the posterior triangle. So, prevertebral fascia is nothing but the tough membrane situated in front of the prevertebral muscles, arises from the cervical part which lies deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Coming to the disposition of the prevertebral fascia horizontally, after its origin, it passes medially and forms the posterior wall of the carotid sheath, then separates out and passes in front of the cervical part of the vertebral column, covering the prevertebral muscles and continues with the fascia of the opposite side. So, after its origin, it will pass medially and form the posterior wall of the carotid sheath, then separates out and passes in front of the cervical part of the vertebral column, covering prevertebral muscles and continues with the fascia of the opposite side. A part of the fascia passes backwards, covering the scalene muscle and levator scapulae and forms the floor of the posterior triangle, and finally lost under the cover of trapezius muscle. In the region of the posterior triangle, it forms the axillary sheath. So here is the black arrow which shows the prevertebral fascia. Here is the pretracheal fascia and here is the investing layer. So you can nicely appreciate three layers in this diagram, okay, along with its attachment. Vertically, prevertebral fascia extends above to attach the bones of the base of the skull. Below, it extends within the thorax up to the thoracic vertebra and finally fuses with the anterior longitudinal ligament. Important features: it forms the posterior wall of the retropharyngeal space. So here is the retropharyngeal space and here is the posterior wall of the retropharyngeal space formed by the prevertebral layer of the deep cervical fascia. It forms the floor of the posterior triangle and it forms the axillary sheath. So the prevertebral fascia will form the axillary sheath, floor of the posterior triangle, posterior wall of the carotid sheath and posterior wall of the retropharyngeal space. Carotid sheath. It is the fascial tubular sheath. Carotid sheath. Carotid sheath is a fascial tubular sheath situated just deep to the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle on each side of front of the neck. It is a condensation of areolar tissues surrounding the carotid arteries, internal jugular vein, and the vagus nerve. It has two walls, anterior wall and posterior wall. Anterior wall is formed by the pretracheal layer of the deep cervical fascia. And the posterior wall of the carotid sheath is formed by the pre-vertebral fascia. So the carotid sheath is a condensation of areolar tissue surrounding the carotid arteries, internal jugular vein, and the vagus nerve. It is formed by the two fascia. The anterior wall is formed by the pretracheal layer of the deep cervical fascia, and the posterior wall is by the pre-vertebral fascia. Coming to the attachment of the carotid sheath, it is attached to the base of the skull, where it is attached to the margins of the carotid canal and the jugular fossa. Below, it is attached to the aortic arch. That means it blends with the tunica adventitia of the aorta. Relations: anteriorly, in the lower part, it is related to the ansa cervicalis, and descendants hypoglossi, and to the anterior border of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Posteriorly, it is related to the sympathetic trunk. So, in this diagram, you can nicely appreciate the carotid sheath. Naturally, this is the schematic diagram of the carotid sheath, which shows the enclosing the three structures: common carotid artery along with the internal carotid artery, then internal jugular vein and the vagus nerve. And in anterior wall, there is a ansa cervicalis, and posteriorly there is a sympathetic chain. Contents of the carotid sheath are: internal jugular vein, which lies laterally. Then there is a common carotid artery and the internal carotid artery. Vagus nerve lies between the internal jugular vein and the common carotid artery, but it lies in the posterior plane. Structure piercing the carotid sheath are: external jugular artery, tributaries of the internal jugular vein, cervical branch of the vagus nerve, glossopharyngeal nerve, and the hypoglossal nerve. So the contents of the carotid sheath are: internal jugular vein, common carotid artery, and the internal carotid artery along with the vagus nerve. And the structure piercing the carotid sheath are: external carotid artery, tributaries of the internal jugular vein, cervical branch of the vagus nerve, glossopharyngeal nerve, and the hypoglossal nerve. Applied importance of the carotid sheath. Carotid sheath is frequently exposed in the block dissection of the neck during the surgical removal of the deep cervical lymph node. Coming to the buccopharyngeal fascia. In this diagram, you can appreciate this is the buccopharyngeal fascia, and here is the retropharyngeal space. Buccopharyngeal fascia runs parallel to the medial aspect of the carotid sheath. It is a thin lamina given off from the pretracheal fascia. It forms a distinct layer just up to the posterior part of the buccinator muscle, and it envelops the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle. It lies posterior to the esophagus and forms the anterior wall of the retropharyngeal space. So the buccopharyngeal fascia is a thin lamina given off from the pretracheal fascia. It forms a distinct layer in the posterior part of the buccinator muscle, and it envelops the superior constrictor muscle. So here is the buccopharyngeal fascia. Also, you can appreciate the buccopharyngeal fascia. The buccopharyngeal fascia forms the pterygomandibular raphe between the hamulus of the medial pterygoid plate and the posterior end of the myelohyoid line of the mandible, providing the attachment to the superior pharyngeal constrictor muscle. So the buccopharyngeal fascia forms the pterygomandibular raphe. Coming to the pharyngobasilar fascia, it is situated between the mucus and the muscular layers. It attaches the wall of the pharynx to the base of the cranium. It is thick above, and it is firmly connected to the basilar portion of the occipital bone and the petrous portion of the temporal bone. As it descends, it diminishes in thickness and gradually lost. So the pharyngobasilar fascia is present between the mucus and the muscular layer. It attaches to the wall of the pharynx to the base of the cranium. It is thick and firmly connected to the basilar portion of the occipital and the petrous portion of the temporal bones. So here you can see the pharyngobasilar fascia. And similarly, here is the alar fascia, and in between there is a retropharyngeal space. Again, here you can see the pharyngobasilar fascia. Coming to the alar fascia, alar fascia lies between the prevertebral fascia and the buccopharyngeal fascia. Cranially, it reaches the skull, and caudally, it reaches the second thoracic vertebra. It forms the posterior border of the retropharyngeal space. So, in this diagram, you can nicely appreciate here is the retropharyngeal space, and here is the buccopharyngeal fascia, and here is the alar fascia. So, this is the diagram showing the tracing of the investing layer, pretracheal layer, and the prevertebral layer of the deep cervical fascia. From the one diagram, you can write down the tracing and the attachments of the deep cervical fascia. For the deep cervical fascia, you may get full question on the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. Short notes on the pretracheal, prevertebral layers of the deep cervical fascia. Then you may get 2 mark short note on ligamentum vari, carotid sheath, then structure enveloped by the carotid sheath, structure pierced by the carotid sheath. Then you get the short note on the buccopharyngeal fascia, pharyngobasilar fascia, and the alar fascia. All these are for 2 marks questions. Okay. Thank you.